Moses was adopted by the Egyptian princess, the Pharaoh's daughter. And then God protected Moses when he was about 40 years old, because Moses got mad at an Egyptian taskmaster, and Moses actually killed the taskmaster, and then Moses fled to Midian. God prophetically directed Moses' ministry through a burning bush at Mount Sinai. God pushed Moses to stir the Hebrew slaves to revolt against Pharaoh. Remember, let my people go. God parted the waters for Moses as Moses led the Hebrews out of captivity and out into the wilderness. God made provisions for Moses in the wilderness by providing manna and quail, and even provided a stick to provide water for the Hebrews. God even provided a pen that wrote down the Ten Commandments, right, God's finger, on tablets of stone, and provided the law to the Hebrew people through Moses. God presented Moses with the tabernacle and instructions for a holy priesthood. God provided patience for Moses during the 40 years of wandering around in the wilderness with all of the grumbling Hebrews. And God personally dug Moses' grave and delivered the Hebrews to the promised land. The Jews deeply admired Moses greatly, because more than prophets who only had visions and dreams of God, more than angels who were in the presence of God, Moses saw God face to face and had a regular encounter with God. And because of that, the Jews greatly admired him. And here's the wild thing for us today as we study through this passage. Moses is no different than you. You have that same access to God today. You may never see a burning bush. God may never hand you the Ten Commandments, but I guarantee they're in here. I could point them out to you. You can encounter God on a daily basis in the same way. And just as the Jews esteemed Moses, so every person who wants a relationship with God should esteem you today. Let's get your Bibles out. Dave's going to hand out some Bibles. If you don't have one, just stick your hand up. We're going to be going to Hebrews chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. What's important is to realize the relationship that Christ has with us and Moses. And that no matter how good we thought Moses was, he still failed. We fail. Right? Remember, Moses lost his temper and actually killed a man. Moses was slow in speech. He actually needed Aaron to be his mouthpiece. And Moses disobeyed God and wasn't even allowed in the promised land. That's the difference. Christ will never fail. He has patience. The scriptures say, may the Lord direct your hearts into God's love and in Christ's perseverance. Christ doesn't need anybody to speak for him. He doesn't need an Aaron. He suffered on the cross and ascended into heaven. He doesn't need anybody. There's not another story that needs to be told after that. And Christ is waiting to bring us into the promised land. There's no sin that we have in our life that will keep us. If we can call faithful our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, if we can call him faithful in our lives, we too will be entered into the promised land with Christ. We need a way to God that does not fail, because to be cut off from God is death and darkness and torment for our entire lives, for all eternity. Our greatest need in life is that we need a faith that cannot fail. Our faith must be preserved. It must be real. And if we desire, earnestly and honestly desire to have eternal life, if we desire it more than the law, desire more than what Moses taught, if we desire to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, if our faith perseveres until the end, then we know we have eternal hope for all time and eternity. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord and Savior, we are thankful that in Jesus Christ we do have a faith that it perseveres. It keeps going on and on, Lord. And we're thankful that as we look at every aspect of faith, Lord, you are in it. It's not up to us, Lord. It's really up to you, and it's just about obedience for us, Lord. We pray that we would be faithful servants, Lord, that we would be admirers of you, Lord, and that in all ways we would model our lives, model our actions, and seek to glorify you in all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so you should have a handout that looks something like this today, and you'll probably want it, because we're going to be referring back to it as we go through the scriptures this morning. Again, we're going to start in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1, Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1 today. You know what? I actually put down the wrong thing. It should say Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1 is where we're going to start. And as we go through the scriptures, we are going to be looking through the five W's: who, what, where, when, why, how. And there's like an H in there, right? So I'll tell you them as we're walking through them. But you're going to want to keep those notes as we go through, because when we get to the end, we're going to kind of rearrange them and make them all come together. So Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1. Therefore, holy brothers, you who share in a heavenly calling, consider Jesus the apostle and high priest of our confession. The heavenly calling. This is interesting. You see, heavenly calling, two simple words that we don't often think about. We talk to people who are not saved, and we say, you should consider Jesus because you want to consider getting to heaven. But remember, the scripture's talking to third-generation Christians. He's actually talking to those of us who follow in the pattern of the Hebrews that were then Christians at this time. And there's two parts to this. There's a calling. There's a God-given desire to understand and share in God's glory. That's the what. That's the first what. A calling. It's a God-given desire to share what comes from God. The what. And then there's the heaven. He's calling us where? That's the second one. Our eternal hope is to be with Jesus. Where? So God is calling us to heaven. What? And he's calling us where? He's calling us to heaven. That's the where. So let me tell you about this, how you put this together. Your faith, your heavenly calling should be something that makes you distinct. Not every person who walks the face of this planet has a heavenly calling. Those of us who put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ have this. That is what distinguishes those of us who know that we're going to heaven from everybody else. We have a heavenly calling. We know we're going upward. In fact, you'll know that you have this because people probably think you're nuts at times. In fact, they should think you're nuts. You think differently than other people. You weren't naturally hardwired to think about a heavenly calling, right? This isn't the way we naturally think. All people consider eternity. Every person that's ever walked the face of the earth considers, where did I come from? Why am I here and where am I going? But not all people have a heavenly calling. That is, they know that they are going to eternity with God. Maybe people think you're a holy roller. And I'll tell you, that's okay. If your thoughts are preoccupied, if your actions are preoccupied with thinking about getting to heaven, what does my relationship with God look like to get to heaven? That's a good thing. This should be a time to cause you some concern. If you do not ever think about getting to heaven, be concerned. Seriously. If you think that all eternity is spent living in the ground rotting, you should be really concerned. I mean, seriously. Every person is hardwired to know about eternity, and if your definition of going to eternity is spending it in the ground, right, or coming back in some cosmic karma thing, be concerned. Our calling is heavenward. We know the destination. We know where we're going, heaven, and we know where, what we're getting called. We're getting called from God. Well, this next part is really interesting here as well. It says, consider Jesus. Well, why would I consider Jesus? He's already talking to Christians. Yeah, that's exactly the point. You get it? Christ is saying, don't take your faith lackadaisical. Take it seriously. Consider Jesus. That means the object of your faith, the how, that's the how part, the object of our faith is Jesus. We have to consider him all the time. This isn't something that we just did once. I walked down the aisle once and I was saved, or I said a prayer and I was saved. Certainly, saved once, always saved. But the begging here from Scripture is to continually consider Jesus. When we look at that whole thing put together, it gives us the how. How do we know that we're saved? Because I am continually considering the object of my faith, Jesus Christ. So how is our faith accomplished? It's accomplished through Jesus Christ. In fact, it's further qualified because it says in this passage that Jesus, comma, the apostle and high priest of our confession. What does that mean? Well, the apostle is the one who is sent from heaven, right? Jesus is the how that accomplished our faith. He's the one that put the relationship with God in place. It answers how it works, the apostle part of Jesus. He's also the high priest. He's the one who sacrifices, right? That answers how our faith is accomplished. It's accomplished through the reconciliation with God. There's two parts to that, right? So it's the apostle is the how faith is accomplished through a relationship, and the high priest is how faith is accomplished through reconciliation. Both of them define Jesus in a more defined manner. Jesus isn't some artificial Mr. Rogers. I even wore my blue sweater, right? We think so often that Jesus is just the nice Jesus and scooping up the children, and he was. He was. But did he not also say, I have not come to bring peace, but to bring what? The sword. Absolutely. Think of that. No government ever put Mr. Rogers to death for teaching that he was threatening. Mr. Rogers is not threatening. Christ is. Mr. Rogers' life is not the most controversial topic in all of history. Jesus's is. Nobody ever got martyred to get into Mr. Rogers' neighborhood. It doesn't happen. You know why? It's make-believe. When you die, it's real. You're really dead. There's no puppet show. There are angels that talk about the heavenlies, the principalities that are working around us, real spiritual things. You can't put your sneakers on and get to heaven. It won't happen. You need to consider the real Jesus, both when you're saved and continually as a believer in Jesus Christ. We need to be faithful to our confession. We need to have the shield of faith. We need to have not sneakers, but shoes that are rooted in the gospel. We need to have, before you die, the helmet of salvation. Without it, I guarantee it's not a happy neighborhood. Otherwise, there won't be, we'll be back in a new day. There's not going to be a new day. Someday when Christ comes back, it's a new day. But it's those people who have considered Jesus permanently for all time and eternity that's going to live with him for a happy day. For everybody else, it's not quite such a pleasant story. Okay, let's look at our second point here, being faithful to our Creator. We're going to move on in this passage. So let me quickly recap. The what is the calling. The God-given desire to share in God's glory. Heaven, that's the where. Our eternal hope is to be with Jesus. The how. Jesus is the faith. He is the faith, the true object of our faith. And now we're going to talk about the why. Look at verse 2. Who was faithful? This is talking about Christ. Who was faithful to him who appointed him, just as Moses also was faithful in God, in all God's house. Okay, so let's talk about this. This is where you start to see this comparison between Moses and Christ. Well, it's talking about a building here. You'll see that as we get a little bit further. And Moses was also faithful in all God's house. Well, there's a building. Well, what's the difference between Christ and Moses? Moses was part of the building. You get it? The building. God is building up a people, and Moses was but one of those people. There's a big difference between the builder and the building. Moses, no matter how much the Jews envied him, no matter how much we should envy him, no matter how many great things were done, he is but the building. Christ is the builder. Make no mistake about it, that's God's house. And he is the why, because he is the creator, we are faithful. Because God, Jesus Christ himself is the creator, we are faithful. It answers the why. You know, we get all caught up in the building. We think of all of the things that go on in the church, in church tradition. We think of how all of these things work together. And there was a Christian scholar who said this about being caught up in the tradition of the building and how the church should function. He says, tradition is the living faith of those now dead, traditionalism is the dead faith of those still living. You get it? Tradition is the living faith of those now dead. Traditionalism is the dead faith of those still living. When we get all wrapped up in our lives about how the church should specifically function and look and whether we should play a particular type of music or we should have a particular type of liturgy or whatever it is, the object of our faith is wrong. The why of our faith is on us. It's not on the Creator God, which is where the object of our faith needs to be. It answers why. Why are we faithful to God? Because He has created the building. This is an object of God's design, specifically designed for God's intents and purposes, and we are a part of it, just like Moses was part of it. We read that big declaration about all those different ways in which God touched Moses' life, and you know what? The difference between Moses and you is Moses' life was penned down in this book. Yours wasn't, but I guarantee God has a book with your life being penned in it right now. It is being recorded. Every moment of your life is being recorded, and in the same way that God is faithful in building Moses' life as a building, as a bride, He is building your life in the same way. He is writing it down right now and recording it. That's why we are to be faithful. We are to be faithful because we are focused not on the building. We are to be focused on the builder God. Continue with me here in verse 3 and 4. For Jesus had been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, as much more glory as the builder of a house has more honor than the house itself. For every house is built by someone, but the builder of all things is God. We need to just kind of resonate on that for a second. Our faith is something that we need to savor. We need to just kind of hold on to it. God is the master builder of the universe, and faith is calling you to heaven. You'll start to see how these what, where, how, and whys all work together. God is the master builder of the universe, and faith is calling you to heaven, His home. He's calling you through His Son, Jesus Christ, who sacrificed Himself to preserve you. You see, all the actions are on Him. It's not on us, the building. It's on the builder. That's why we need to savor our faith. Because all of the actions of our faith are from God. They're not by us. Those things that we build ultimately will be crumbled up and destroyed in the final days. Any works that we have will be destroyed. But any work that God does is worthy of faithfulness because He is continually building it. God's the master builder of the universe. He is faithfully calling you to heaven, His home, through His Son, Jesus Christ, who sacrificed Himself to preserve you. Why is our faith preserved? Because of Jesus. Why is our faith real? Because of Jesus. Don't make any mistake about it. Your faith isn't real because you believe it. It's real because Jesus made it real. Your faith is real because God created faith for you to enjoy. You didn't concoct God in your brain. And whether you believe it or not, God is real. And someday when you say, I don't want to listen to God on this particular issue, or I want to ignore God, or I don't want to listen to godly wisdom here and there, it's a fallacy. God's truth is real. God's faith is real. It's how you participate with it. You get it? It's huge. If our faith was based on ourselves, it would crumble. It would fall apart. And our third point, faithfulness is a confirmation of our faith. What you'll see here is the who. And we're going to start focusing in on those of us who are saved. Look with me here at verse 5. Now Moses was faithful in all God's house as a servant to testify to those things that were spoken later. I think this gets at the who. Moses is a servant. And there's a juxtaposition. Those of us who are servants in the house. So Moses is clearly a servant. He's a member of God's house, just like we are members of God's house. The interesting thing about servants is they don't own anything in the house. You don't own any one thing in God's house. Servants are lavished because they are in the presence of the owner. You get it? Your faith is built up not because of you own something particular with inside of God's house. Your faith is built up because being in the presence of God, being in communion with God, He is able to lavish His presence about you or on you. See, Moses is real good, and we might be good also from our worldly view. But just like us, Moses is a servant. He has no blessings that are inherent upon himself, just like we have no blessings that are inherent upon ourselves. There is nothing good, nothing internally that you can do that will cause God to give you blessings to yourself just because you're a good person. God gives you blessing because He chooses to give you blessings. When you live a life that is in God's will, He will bless your life and lavish your life because you are a servant in His house. And as a faithful servant living in His house, He bestows blessings upon those that are in His presence. You get it? Who has the blessings of faith? Only those who are the inherited sons of God. It's the who. So who has real faith? Those who are servants. Those who are not only servants, but those who are actually inherited by God is the who, the brethren, those of us. In John 14:6, it says, I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Only those of us who call Jesus Christ our faithful Savior fit into the who category. That's who. The blessings of faith are bestowed to the brethren whose faith is real. Look with me at verse 6. But Christ is faithful over God's house as a son, and we are His house if indeed we hold fast to our confidence and our boasting in our hope. Okay, so the calling was a desire to share in God's glory. That's the what. The heaven was the where. Jesus is the true object. That's the how. The creator of all things is God. He's worthy of our faithfulness. That's the why. And the who is those who are in faith are the brethren. This last point gets to the when. And there's 2 points in this verse here. But Christ is faithful over God's house as a son, and we are His household if indeed we hold fast. Hold fast. That has this concept of like right now, right? The when is now. Now we need a faith that sustains every moment of our life right now. If we call ourselves, as the third generation Hebrews did here, brethren, we answered the who question, we now need the when. When do we hold faith? Right now. Every single moment of our life, we need to have faith in God. There's a second part to that also. We need to hold fast our confidence and our boasting and our hope. But it's also when, it's for the rest of your life. That's our hope. So as faithful brothers and sisters in Christ, our faith is supported every single minute by Jesus Christ, and it will continue every minute until we die. Because we have hope. The rest of our life of becoming a Christian and following Christ is the same moment as when you got saved. Think of it this way. There was a moment in your life, if you are saved, if you know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, where you put the object of your faith, your eternal destiny, in the person and the work of Jesus Christ. That when happened at a moment. But that win for all brethren, all people who consider themselves Christian, has to continue every single minute for the rest of your life. Sure, there are times in your life when you doubt. You doubt your faith. But in the final analysis, those people who call themselves brothers, those people who are going to heaven, have put their faith on a regular, ongoing basis in Jesus Christ. And if you ever doubt that you're going to heaven, go back to the moment when you were saved, when you knew that. Go back to some moment in your life when you felt a deep connection with God, and don't let it go. That moment will continue on and on and on and on and on through the rest of your life. It's a faith that's worth boasting about. If you ever doubt your salvation, go back to those moments in your life where you boasted about your relationship with Jesus Christ. That point where you're so excited to tell people. Or that point when you were at the lowest of lows in your life and you just couldn't think of a way out of it. And you saw that God had His hand around your life, just like He had His hand around Moses' life. Alexander, I'm going to have a hard time pronouncing this last name, Solzhenitsyn was a Russian and a Soviet novelist and a historian. His writings helped make the world know about the Gulag. And the Gulag was the Soviet Union's forced labor camps during World War II and a little bit later. And during Alexander's 8 years in the Gulag, his parents died. His wife then divorced him. And upon his release from prison in 1953, he found out he was dying of cancer. It was growing so rapidly, these tumors were growing all over his body so rapidly, he could write notes down every 12 hours as he felt the tumors spread. He wrote this at the point that he was getting out of prison, ready to abandon himself. He looked at God and he said, "There is no other thing. Oh God, how easy it is for me to believe in you." Think of that. How easy it is for me to believe in you. You created a path for through despair. Oh God, you have used me, and where you cannot use me, you have appointed others. Thank you. Just think of that. His life has fallen apart. His parents died. His wife left him. He spent 8 years in the Gulag. Tumors are rattling his bodies. And all he can think of is that as he finally recognized the work that God is doing in his life, that God has offered him a path of faithfulness forward. It begs the question, how real is our faith? The interesting thing about Alexander's life, and I think many of our own lives, is we can look at difficult situations in life when the chips are really down and we can say, "I put my faith in Jesus Christ." The interesting thing about Alexander is for whatever reason, the tumors left. Like within 6 months, there were no more tumors. The cancer went into complete remission. Some 20 years later, he moved to America. And what was interesting is that He actually was harshly criticized in the United States because he actually put some quotes together. He said, "The human soul longs for the higher things, for the warmer, the pursuit of those things that are offered beyond what the masses have available to them. TV has become a stupor and our music has become intolerable." You see, when the chips are down, I think that people can get themselves rallied around faith. But what Alexander was pointing at is it's not on the hard points in life. It's in our daily circumstances where the measure of faith is found. Certainly, when life is difficult, we will rally and rally and rally to God because you know what? He's driven us to our knees. We have no other choice. But my friends, today, your faith is being challenged not only in the hard times, but in every single moment of your life. As you watch TV, what are you watching? As you choose to go to movies, what are you going to? As you pick friends, who are you talking to? Whose advice and counsel are you seeking? As you drive down the road and you cut somebody off, how are you driving? In what ways, in every single moment of your life, is your faith being displayed? Think of it. If our faith is a sign of our eternal inheritance in heaven, then every single moment counts on how we live and display and enjoy our faith in Jesus Christ. Well, let me finish up by, one, making sure you got the win here, and then we'll rewrap these five W's and an H. The win was, again, right now and for every moment as you go forward. So if I reorganize these things, right, the way you normally hear about these is who, what, where, when, why, and how. So the who's the brethren, those of us whose faith is real. The what is the calling, that God has given us a desire to share in God's glory. The where is heaven. Our eternal hope is to be with Jesus in heaven someday. The when is right now and for the rest of your life that you will demonstrate real faith by being faithful to God. Why? Because God is the creator of all things and he is worthy of our faithfulness. And the how? The how is through Jesus Christ because he is the true bond, the real connection, the true object of our faith. So let me turn this into a preposition, into a statement. Brethren, if your faith is real, you will demonstrate it by desiring to glorify God with a single eternal hope to be with Jesus because he is worthy of our faithfulness and he is the true object of our faith. You see, we just put all of those together into a big sentence. If your faith is real, brethren, that's you who are saved. If your faith is real, you will demonstrate it by desiring to glorify God with a single eternal hope to be with Jesus because he is worthy of our faithfulness and is the true object of our faith. Let me simplify it. Brethren, real faith desires to glorify God through eternal hope in Jesus Christ, the true object of our faith. Those of us who are saved will desire to glorify God through our eternal hope in Jesus Christ, the true object of our faith. We can even simplify this even more. Saved people desire to glorify God by putting their faith in Jesus Christ. You can even make it even more assertive. If you are saved or want to be saved, through faith in Christ we are saved and glorified. Through faith in Christ we are saved and glorified. But you say, I'm already saved. I don't need this. Then it's very simple. In Christ, every day I will glorify God. In Christ, every single day, regardless of whether the chips are down, whether life is good or life is bad, every single day I will live to glorify God in Christ. In Christ, I will glorify God. It's time to be faithful, to be encouraging, to be upbeat, to know that our faith can be real, not because it's reliant on us, but faith is real because of Jesus Christ, and because of Jesus Christ, we can glorify God with a real, genuine faith. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord and Savior, I thank you for our time together today, Lord. Lord, those of us who call you Savior, Lord, we desire to know every moment of our lives that we are in good hands, Lord. We desire to be cared for, to be nurtured, to grow up in wisdom and godly wisdom, Lord. And we know that this is true and possible, Lord, because it is you, the author of our faith, that protects us, that cares for us. Just like Moses, we could see the writing in his life, Lord, that through every step of his life, you cared for him. And in that same way, Lord, you care for us. You desire for us a strong, faithful relationship, a faith that is enduring, a faith that grows, and a faith that builds us up in the knowledge and the comfort and in a life bonded to Jesus Christ. Amen.